Good evening. I'm Jeff Bennett. Amna Nawaz is on assignment. On the NewsHour tonight, Kamala Harris hits the campaign trail with Republican Liz Cheney, while Donald Trump uses increasingly crass rhetoric during his political events. Israel targets banks linked to Hezbollah. How the strikes could hurt the militia group, but also civilians trying to weather Lebanon's financial crisis. And an academic initiative works to revive liberal arts as a key part of the college experience.
I'm not trying to get students away from engineering or business degrees. I'm trying to give them just a much more complete education.
Major funding for the PBS News Hour has been provided by the ongoing support of these individuals and institutions, and friends of the News Hour, including Leonard and Norma Glorfine and the Judy and Peter Bloom Kovler Foundation.
Two retiring executives turn their focus to Greyhounds, giving these former race dogs a real chance to win. A Raymond James financial advisor gets to know you, your purpose, and the way you give back. Life well planned.
You know, as somebody coming out of college, it can be very nerve-wracking, not knowing what to expect, whether you'll like your job or not, whether you'll make friends, whether you'll fit in. And here, I feel like it's so welcoming and such an inclusive place to work. You just feel like you're valued.
The William and Flora Hewlett Foundation. For more than 50 years, advancing ideas and supporting institutions to promote a better world at Hewlett.org. And with the ongoing support of these individuals and institutions. This program was made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you.
Welcome to the NewsHour. As we near the two-week mark to Election Day, former President Donald Trump traveled to North Carolina to see the aftermath of Hurricane Helene, while Vice President Kamala Harris toured swing states alongside former Republican Congresswoman Liz Cheney. Laura Barone Lopez has this report.
The Democratic nominee for president campaigned with unlikely company today, Republicans.
This election is presenting, for the first time probably in certainly recent history, a very clear choice and difference between the two nominees. And I think that is what, as much as anything, is bringing us as Americans together.
Vice President Kamala Harris spent the day in moderated conversations with former Republican Congresswoman Liz Cheney, starting in Pennsylvania.
I've spent time working in countries where people aren't free and where people are struggling for their freedom. And I know how quickly democracies can unravel. But I tell you, again, as someone who has seen firsthand how quickly it can happen, that is what's on the ballot.
It's the latest in a string of unprecedented events Harris has held with Republican figures like Cheney. The pair then made their way to Michigan for another event.
What is at stake in this election is so fundamental that it really does cross partisan lines.
Meanwhile, Harris's running mate, Governor Tim Walz, spent the morning with the hosts of The View.
Nothing Donald Trump is proposing does anything about the middle class, and every economist, Moody's themselves, talked about what it would do to drive up inflation, potentially leading us to recession. So there's more work to be done. We acknowledge that. I think the vice president's proposals are real.
Former President Donald Trump was in Swannanoa, North Carolina, to tour storm damage from the recent hurricane.
But it's vital that we not let this hurricane that has taken so much also take your voice. You must get out and vote.
Trump repeated baseless claims about the federal government's response to the disaster.
Certainly, you have all heard the same stories that we all hear, that FEMA has done a very poor job. They were not supposed to be spending the money on taking in illegal migrants, maybe so they could vote in the election, because that's a lot of people are saying that's why they're doing it.
Later, the former president again deployed dark and anti-immigrant rhetoric in Greenville, North Carolina.
Under the Trump administration, we are going to take back what is ours. We will end the looting, ransacking, raping, and pillaging of North Carolina and, frankly, every other state in the Union.
On Sunday, Trump scooped French fries and served fast food to staged customers at a Pennsylvania McDonald's. The political stunt comes as Trump has accused Harris, without any evidence, of lying about her college job at a McDonald's. On the same day, in an interview with Fox News, Trump again described Democrats like Adam Schiff and Nancy Pelosi as enemies from within.
You talk about the enemy within. There's enemies, America's enemies outside. The enemy within is a pretty ominous phrase if you're talking about other Americans.
I think it's accurate. I mean, I think it's accurate. But when you look at Shifty Schiff and some of the others, yeah, they are, to me, the enemy from within. I think Nancy Pelosi is an enemy from within. She lied.
It's rhetoric Trump used against fellow Americans on a podcast days earlier.
They were saying, he said the enemy from within. Of course, it's Adam Schiff. These are bad people. These are sick people and bad people.
Speaker of the House Mike Johnson deflected when asked on CNN this weekend if Trump's vows to use the National Guard against political enemies was okay.
What President Trump is talking about is that they have been attacking and maligning him from the day he came down that golden escalator. Everybody knows that's true.
At a rally on Saturday in Latrobe, Pennsylvania, hometown of the golf legend Arnold Palmer, the former president started talking about the late golfer's genitalia.
Arnold Palmer was all man, and I say that in all due respect to women, and I love women. He took showers with the other pros. They came out of there, they said, oh my God.
At the same rally, Trump used an expletive when talking about Vice President Harris.
We can't stand you, you're a vice president.
In an MSNBC interview with Al Sharpton on Sunday, Harris said the American people deserve better.
And what you see in my opponent, a former president of the United States, really is, it demeans the office. And I have said, and I'm very clear about this, Donald Trump should never again stand behind the seal of the president of the United States. He has not earned the right.
For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Laura Barone-Lopez.
Turning now to the Middle East, Israel has launched new attacks in Beirut despite U.S. requests to limit strikes in the Lebanese capital. The target was a financial organization that Israel and the U.S. call Hezbollah's bank, but the bank also provides loans to Lebanese civilians, and human rights groups worry the strikes only worsen the country's financial and humanitarian crises. That's as the U.S. is looking into a leaked document revealing Israel's preparations for attacking Iran. Nick Schifrin reports.
Overnight, right outside the Beirut airport's gates, an Israeli airstrike. Israel ordered the area evacuated before massive airstrikes that destroyed entire buildings and burned storefronts in Hezbollah's stronghold in southern Beirut. By day, those buildings lay crumpled next to apartment complexes whose sides are now blown out. The strikes hit from northern Lebanon in the hills of the Bekaa Valley to Zahrani in the south.
Our store and our livelihood are gone. This neighborhood is all civilian. Our store is right there, and everything is gone.
Across the country, the targets were Al-Qard al-Hassan that Israel and the U.S. Treasury say Hezbollah uses to manage the group's finances. Herzi Halevi is Israel's top general on a visit today to southern Lebanon.
We struck close to 30 targets across Lebanon, Hezbollah's financial system, Al-Qard al-Hassan, which receives funds from Iran, provides loans, and ultimately finances Hezbollah's terrorism.
One of the things that's unique about Al-Qard al-Hassan is that it is primarily involved in cash and in gold. And so it is possible by destroying the right brick-and-mortar Al-Qard al-Hassan entities to destroy a lot of their U.S. dollars.
Matt Levitt directs the Washington Institute's Counterterrorism and Intelligence Program and is the former Deputy Assistant Secretary for Intelligence at Treasury.
What the Israelis do want to do is make sure that Hezbollah can't finance its militia terrorist activity and will have difficulty rebuilding itself once the dust settles.
But the airstrikes have sparked a humanitarian crisis, and driven a quarter of the country to flee their homes.
There is no safe place, and they just don't know how to cope because they just fear for their life.
Damian Marquette is the Lebanon Emergency Team Leader for the International Rescue Committee, which says 90% of the population is not able to meet its basic needs.
People in the streets will say, we just need a roof. People who had a roof would say, like, we need shelter material, we need a blanket, we need a mattress, we need water, we need food.
The numbers of casualties have been, civilian casualties have been far too high.
Even before today, U.S. officials objected to the extent of Israeli airstrikes in Beirut. Today, top presidential envoy Amos Hochstein blamed Hezbollah and acknowledged the destruction the war had wrought.
A resolution was possible, but it was rejected. And the situation has escalated out of control as we feared that it could.
Israelis today remain focused on Hezbollah rockets and drones, more than 170 intercepted today, including above the heads of mourners who took cover at a cemetery as they buried a man killed this past weekend by a Hezbollah strike nearby in northern Israel. And Israel is preparing to strike Iran for its unprecedented attack of 180 ballistic missiles on October the 1st. An Israeli official tells PBS NewsHour the Israeli cabinet has not yet approved a response. But a document posted online last week reveals U.S. spy satellites picked up Israel preparing long-range air-launched ballistic missiles, covert drone operations, and conducting a second large military exercise, but no indications that Israel intends to use a nuclear weapon. U.S. officials said today they do not expect additional similar documents to go public, as Secretary of State Antony Blinken left today for his 11th trip to Israel since the October 7th attacks. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Nick Schifrin.
And we start the day's other headlines in New Mexico, where water levels are starting to recede after record rainfall left at least two people dead. National Guard officials say more than 300 people have been rescued since Saturday, with dozens brought to nearby hospitals with injuries. The National Weather Service says nearly 6 inches of rain fell on Roswell on Saturday, breaking a record set back in 1901. That sent water gushing down streets, trapping vehicles, and leaving entire homes submerged. Tropical storm Oscar battered eastern Cuba today as the entire island deals with an electrical grid failure that has left millions without power. Oscar made landfall as a Category 1 hurricane in the Guantanamo province late yesterday with winds of 70 miles per hour. It unleashed up to 20 inches of rain in some areas, raising concerns about flooding and mudslides. On the other side of the island, protesters in Havana banged pots and pans amid ongoing blackouts following Friday's nationwide power outage. There are concerns that Oscar could hurt efforts to get the power back on. The White House has proposed a new rule that would require health insurers to cover over-the-counter contraception and birth control at no cost to patients. That's on top of prescribed contraception, which is already covered. The rule would include emergency contraception as well as the new over-the-counter birth control, O-pill. The proposed rule would not affect those on Medicaid, and it has a 60-day public comment period before it would be finalized. The White House today called birth control a fundamental right.
Good afternoon, everyone. We have women out there who don't have the protections that they need on their own health care because Roe v. Wade, which was law of the land for almost a constitutional right for almost 50 years, were stripped away. And we have made that commitment from this administration, the Biden-Harris administration, to protect women, to do everything that we can.
The White House says if approved, the new rule would increase coverage of contraception for 52 million women of reproductive age who have private health insurance. A bipartisan congressional task force says that stunning security failures contributed to the July assassination attempt on former President Trump. The House panel drew on documents, interviews, and briefings to investigate how a gunman managed to open fire on Mr. Trump from a rooftop near his rally in Butler, Pennsylvania. One attendee was killed and two others were wounded in the shooting. The initial report largely blames the Secret Service, saying, quote, the tragic and shocking events of July 13th were preventable and should not have happened. A final report is due in December. Secretary of Defense Lloyd Austin promised to get Ukraine, quote, what it needs during an unannounced visit to the country. Meeting with President Volodymyr Zelensky in the capital, Kyiv, today, Austin backed that up with another $400 million in U.S. military assistance. But Austin didn't address Ukraine's request to use Western-supplied weapons to strike deeper into Russia, and he offered no hints on whether the U.S. would support Zelensky's so-called victory plan. Instead, Austin urged all parties to stay the course.
There is no silver bullet, no single capability will turn the tide. What matters is the way that Ukraine fights back. What matters is the combined effects of your military capabilities. And what matters is staying focused on what works.
Separately, voters in Moldova narrowly approved a referendum to move forward with European Union membership amid accusations that Russia tried to interfere with the vote. Moldova applied to join the EU shortly after Russia's invasion of neighboring Ukraine in 2022. Russia has denied any wrongdoing. The men once known as the Central Park Five are suing Donald Trump for allegedly making defamatory remarks during last month's presidential debate. In their federal complaint, the men write that Trump, quote, falsely stated that plaintiffs killed an individual and pled guilty to the crime. These statements are demonstrably false. The five were accused of the 1989 rape and beating of a white female jogger in New York's Central Park. They said that their confessions at the time were made under duress and their convictions were vacated in 2002. A Trump spokesman called the lawsuit frivolous. On Wall Street today, stocks ended mixed following last week's strong gains. The Dow Jones Industrial Average snapped a three-session winning streak, giving back nearly 350 points. The NASDAQ managed a gain of about 50 points to start the week, and the S&P shed about 10 points, so just a small loss there. And President Biden presented the latest National Medals of Arts at a private ceremony at the White House today. It's the government's highest award for artists and arts patrons. Those being honored include Missy Elliott, Idina Menzel, Queen Latifah, Spike Lee, Steven Spielberg, and Ken Burns. After the event, Mr. Biden hosted a reception for those winners, plus the recipients of the National Humanities Medals, which were also presented today to 19 writers, historians, educators, and filmmakers. Still to come on the NewsHour, billionaire Elon Musk's massive effort to elect Donald Trump and gain influence over the government agencies that regulate his companies. Tamara Keith and Amy Walter break down the latest political headlines. And the widow of Russian dissident Alexei Navalny discusses his posthumous memoir.
This is the PBS NewsHour from the David M. Rubenstein Studio at WETA in Washington, and in the West from the Walter Cronkite School of Journalism at Arizona State University.
The world's richest man, Elon Musk, is now a powerful mega donor for Donald Trump. Musk is using his vast resources to campaign for him in Pennsylvania and taking aggressive measures for Mr. Trump in other key battleground states. Some of those moves are raising major legal and ethical concerns as well. Billionaire entrepreneur Elon Musk unveiling a new tactic to boost Donald Trump's campaign, pledging to randomly award $1 million to registered swing state voters daily through Election Day.
You're most welcome.
The catch? Sign a petition for his pro-Trump political action committee. The petition is in support of the First and Second Amendments.
It's very straightforward. You don't even have to vote. You don't have to vote. You just have to sign a petition saying you believe in the Constitution.
Musk's political action committee, known as America PAC, has already committed $75 million to the Trump campaign. Some election experts say Musk's latest effort could be illegal. That's because federal law prohibits offering, paying, or accepting payment in exchange for voter registration or voting. But Musk and his allies argue there's an important distinction. Payments and voter status aren't directly linked. They say voter registration is merely a prerequisite to sign the petition. Democratic Pennsylvania Governor Josh Shapiro, a supporter of Vice President Kamala Harris, on Sunday called it deeply concerning.
Look, Musk obviously has a right to be able to express his views. I don't deny him that right, but when you start flowing this kind of money into politics, I think it raises serious questions that folks may want to take a look at.
So you think it might not be legal, yes or no?
I think it's something that law enforcement could take a look at.
It's not clear whether federal officials are looking into the payments. In campaign appearances and online, Musk has spread unfounded claims about widespread voter fraud and made incendiary statements about immigration. Donald Trump has already offered him a key appointment if he's reelected.
At the suggestion of Elon Musk, I will create a government efficiency commission tasked with conducting a complete financial and performance audit of the entire federal government and making recommendations for drastic reforms. And Elon, because he's not very busy, has agreed to head that task force.
Let's bring in New York Times investigative reporter David Farenthold, who's been closely following Elon Musk, his connections with Donald Trump, and his business contracts with the federal government. He joins us now. Thanks for being with us.
Hey, it's great to be here.
So before we delve into Elon Musk's political leanings, help us understand the degree to which his sprawling tech empire is entangled with the federal government.
Enormously entangled. It's hard to overstate how entangled Elon Musk is with the federal government, in that there's two dimensions to that. One is the federal government is a customer of his, a huge customer of his. NASA and the Defense Department pay billions of dollars a year to SpaceX to launch their satellites, to launch their people, launch their rockets. There's 300 contracts between the federal government and Elon Musk companies this year alone. The other dimension of that relationship is that he fights with the federal government all the time. Regulators from different agencies are limiting what his companies can do, checking on his companies, making sure they live up to their promises. He doesn't like that. He's often complaining about these different regulators. So there's a good side and there's a bad side, but there's a huge breadth of entanglements between Elon and the federal government.
Meantime, Elon Musk is pouring millions of dollars into Donald Trump's reelection effort. What's the connection between Elon Musk's business interests and Donald Trump's electoral success come Election Day? What's in it for Elon Musk as he sees it?
Well, what he's done is he's sort of prodded Trump to say that if Trump is elected, he will name Elon Musk to be the head of a government efficiency commission, basically a commission that has the responsibility or the power to recommend huge cuts in the spending and the regulation the federal government does. Now, why does that matter for Elon? Well, it matters a lot because now the people that oversee him, the agencies that oversee him, Elon's going to flip that relationship. Now he oversees them. He's the one who could decide, okay, how much is your budget going to be? How much cuts am I going to recommend? So now you're in a situation where the people who are supposed to be keeping tabs on Elon Musk and his companies, making sure that they're safe for the public, he's going to have a position of power over them. So the question is, how will he use that power? And even if he doesn't use it explicitly, how will that sort of chill and scare the regulators who are supposed to be keeping tabs on his businesses?
You and your colleagues report that two of Elon Musk's companies, SpaceX and Tesla, account for at least $15.4 billion in government contracts over the past decade. How did the federal government become so dependent on Elon Musk's companies over the years?
Well, most of that is a story about SpaceX. SpaceX is really good at what it does. It shoots rockets up in the air much more often, much more safely, much more effectively than any of its rivals. And so SpaceX, through some lobbying, but mostly just through its own sheer, skill, has managed to take over the space launch business in the U.S. So that means that for NASA, basically, SpaceX dictates to NASA when NASA can shoot up its biggest payloads, not the other way around. The Defense Department is enormously indebted to SpaceX, is a huge customer of SpaceX's, because SpaceX shoots up their spy satellites and other satellites. And because SpaceX's Starlink satellite communication service provides this incredible satellite service all over the world for communication. So those two agencies alone, NASA and the Defense Department, account for a huge chunk of that spending because they want to be in space, and Mr. Musk's companies are the very best at getting you there.
So it sounds like even if there were federal officials and lawmakers who view Elon Musk as an unreliable or problematic partner, that even if there was a will to roll back some of that dependence, there really isn't a way to do it, at least not yet.
That's right. Elon Musk has said, if Kamala Harris is elected, I'm going to jail or something like that. I'm going to lose my contracts. That's not going to happen. NASA and the Defense Department, which have huge budgets, are hugely dependent on SpaceX. And as we've seen from Boeing's failed attempt to rescue its own astronauts from outer space, there's nobody out there they could even give those contracts to. So even if Kamala Harris gets elected and burns with hatred in her heart for Elon Musk, there's really nothing she could do because the government is so dependent on his companies.
Lastly, there's lots of attention around the legality of these cash incentives that Elon Musk is offering to swing state voters who sign this petition of his. We've not seen anything like this before. What questions does it raise for you as you do your reporting on Elon Musk and these perceived conflicts of interest?
Well, the question for me is whether this is effectively buying a vote. Is he paying you to vote for Donald Trump? Is he paying you to vote at all if he knows you're a supporter of Donald Trump? Legally, what he says he's doing is just paying you to sign this petition, to sign up for this, to get emails from this PAC. That probably, as far as it goes, is legal. But if it becomes a way to pay you for voting for Donald Trump or pay you to incentivize you to vote for Donald Trump, that becomes illegal. However, that said, the enforcement mechanisms for U.S. election law are so weak that if it's just a borderline case, I doubt anything happens to him here.
David Farenthold of The New York Times, thanks for being with us.
Thank you.
Elon Musk's political efforts are just one high-profile effort by Trump allies to win over voters in key battleground states on that. And what else to watch for with just 2 weeks remaining before Election Day? I'm joined now by our Politics Monday duo. That's Amy Walter of the Cook Political Report with Amy Walter and Tamara Keith of NPR. Hello to you both.
Hello.
So the Trump campaign, Tam, has outsourced some of its get-out-the-vote effort to these third-party super PACs, including Elon Musk's. The hitch there seems to be this reporting by Reuters that the PAC, the Elon Musk PAC, is having trouble hitting door-knocking goals, and that some canvassers, according to this reporting, have lied about the numbers of voters that they actually contacted. On a race that hinges on turnout, that seems like this could be problematic for the Trump campaign to have these outside groups doing this crucial work.
Right. Another outside group that's involved is Turning Point USA, run by Charlie Kirk. A lot of these people are very good at getting attention. What we don't know is whether they're very good at a ground game. And the one case study that we have of a campaign saying, all right, I'm going to farm it out. We're going to have this super PAC do it. We're going to focus on the things that we can focus on, like ads and putting the candidate where the candidate should be. That was Ron DeSantis, and it was a disaster. It was not a good case study in what you want to do. And so there is a very open question about whether these efforts will work or whether Elon Musk is proving himself very good at burning millions of dollars. And we won't really know until the election. Though the other thing that I would say that sort of counterbalance to this is that there are a lot of people who believe, including Democrats, that Donald Trump doesn't need a ground game because he is his own ground game. His voters are so motivated that they will crawl over glass to vote for him. And you don't need a big door-knocking effort to get to them.
And that's the lesson of 2016, that Donald Trump can win even with a decentralized or disorganized, as was the case back then, campaign.
And even 2020, the polling certainly suggested that he was not going to hit the numbers he ultimately came up with. But the reason that we're paying so much attention to this ground game isn't just because the race is so close, but the kinds of voters that Trump does best with are the kinds of people who don't show up traditionally to vote. And those people are harder to know, not just who they are, but how to motivate them to get out to vote. So traditional door knocking or, you know, sending, putting pieces of mail, that's not, they don't necessarily respond to the same messages that your voter who turns out in every single election is going to respond to. That takes a level of sophisticated targeting and messaging that you just don't put together on the fly. But ultimately, do I think that if Donald Trump loses, it's because he outsourced his ground game? No, I don't.
Meantime, the Harris campaign is going all in and trying to reach out to those dissatisfied, disaffected Republicans. Unpack your reporter's notebook for us. What are you seeing on the ground, and what does it suggest about their strategy?
So what I've seen, and I was traveling with Harris all weekend, she is making a concerted effort to speak to what you would say are Nikki Haley Republicans. And this is an ongoing effort that includes today stops in all three of the blue wall states, doing events in suburbs specifically targeted at college-educated voters, Republicans, people who would have been Republicans if it wasn't Trump, and trying to convince them to sort of get over whatever discomfort they have and support her. And the reason that the campaign is putting so much effort into this, which in theory, like in a normal year, would feel kind of like a long shot or an afterthought, is that Vice President Harris, they are concerned that she may not do as well with black voters, particularly black men, that she may not do as well with Latino voters, that Trump is making some inroads into the traditional Democratic base, also working class white voters. And so what they're trying to do is run up the numbers in the suburbs where Trump has clearly struggled, where there are tens of thousands of people who voted for Nikki Haley after she dropped out.
Yeah, and this is a perfect example. In Chester County, which is where the campaign was today with Liz Cheney this morning, this is a place where after the Haley campaign was over, she had dropped out of the race, there was still a primary in Pennsylvania, she got about 10,000 votes in Chester County. And remember, Republicans can Pennsylvania has a closed primary, so only Republicans could vote mm-hmm. in that primary. So theoretically, there's 10,000 votes for somebody, named obviously the Harris campaign, hoping it's them, to pick up. And in a state that's been decided by 60,000 votes, 80,000 votes, yeah, 10,000's nothing to sneeze at.
Well, look, while I have you all here, can we look at a latest poll?
Why not?
Sure.
Let's delve in. So this is a Washington Post poll of likely voters in battleground states. Doing my quick electoral math, this shows a slight Harris lead. Tam, how is the campaign feeling about a poll like this?
Well, I think they feel about this poll like they feel about all polls, which is, you know, the way Harris said it this weekend is, and the way she's been saying it for a while, but it sounds like she really means it now. This race is close. They acknowledge it's close. It's going to take a lot of work to make it better than close for them. And she has said that they are running like underdogs. She has said repeatedly that either you are running scared or you are running stupid, and they would rather run scared. Now, would they love to have better poll numbers? Yes, of course they would. But this race has been incredibly stable. We are talking about all of these movements are within the margin of error. All of these movements are statistically not even that significant.
Amy, when you dig deep into these numbers and other polls that I'm sure you have access to that we mere mortals do not.
No. I would share with you guys.
What do you see? What do you see 15 days out? A little more than 2 weeks away.
Yeah, it is a question. I think there are two questions. One, who are these undecided voters? Overwhelmingly, they are younger. It's a more diverse group of voters. They tend to be more heavily female. And on paper, those would look like Democrats, except that they also tend to be more economically sensitive and very, very worried about the economy, which is why when you see the Harris ad that is running the most, it is talking about the economy and middle class economy and calling out Trump for being for billionaires and not being for regular people. It's an interesting, you know, she obviously has a lot of different messages to a lot of different groups, but if you're talking about who are those last bastion of swing voters, those undecided voters, the economy and being able to sell her on the economy or at least lessen Trump's advantage on that, they believe is really the key.
And Tam, you were just with the Harris campaign in Nebraska's second congressional district, just to, again, to reiterate how closely and how hard fought this election is.
Yeah, so this is known as the blue dot or the purple dot that could be the blue dot this time. And if Harris, of these swing states that we're talking about, if Harris were to only win the blue wall of Michigan, Pennsylvania, and Wisconsin, she would be at 269 electoral votes, one shy of what is needed to win the presidency. And that is where Omaha comes in. And just to give a sense of the Harris campaign ground game, they have three campaign offices there. Now, they're combined campaign offices. There's also a competitive House race there. But they have volunteers. I was watching them phone bank. They were chasing ballots. And there's also this kind of quirky grassroots effort that has sprung up with people putting blue dots in their yards. More than 10,000 signs have been made, many of them with blue spray paint that's all over their hands. And then Republicans responding with some red Pac-Man things to eat the blue dot and also a big red state of Nebraska. It is fun to see a place where they believe that their vote matters and they are incredibly politically engaged and it's not super toxic.
Yeah. Tamara Keith and Amy Walter, thank you both so much.
You're welcome.
Online on TikTok, Arlisa Desjardins and Dima Zane have been counting down to Election Day, giving us a fun and insightful fact each day. Here's what they have for us today.
Only 15 people have become president after being vice president.
We'll call it the death of the humanities. That's been a leading story about colleges over the last decade or so, and numbers bear it out. Majors in English and history are down by a third. Humanities enrollment overall is down by almost a fifth. But there's also another story to be told. Jeffrey Brown traveled to Purdue University to take a look for our higher education series, Rethinking College.
Most people would lie to you if given the opportunity. So there's nothing wrong with you lying to them first.
Welcome to the Machiavelli School of Management. Today's prompt, passages from The Prince, published in 1532.
Because men are wretched creatures who would not keep their word to you, you need not keep your word to them.
A classic text, small discussion groups, back and forth debate about ethics in today's world.
Does it work? Good argument, bad argument.
I think it's a bad argument.
Why?
Because it's basically saying that you have to expect that you're going to be the sucker.
A philosophy professor, Brian Kogelman, working with freshman business and marketing majors like 18-year-old Savannah Espinola.
He really pushes us. He says, okay, why? Why do you believe that? And he makes us come up with clear arguments and defend our reasoning. And he makes sure we're clear about it.
The course is part of Cornerstone, a general education program that injects the liberal arts into all realms of the freshman academic experience.
It's about understanding your humanity, cultivating your inner life, and understanding the world and having empathy for other people.
History professor Melinda Zook runs Cornerstone.
I define it as giving students that are not liberal arts majors a more holistic education that includes courses that will have them reading classic texts, have them experience the arts.
Purdue is one of the country's leading universities for engineering and other STEM fields. Proud to showcase its more than two dozen astronaut graduates, including Neil Armstrong. It was also experiencing its version of a national trend that saw the number of humanities graduates fall by nearly a third in the decade before the pandemic.
Between 2010, 2011, and 2015, this College of Liberal Arts had lost about 20% of its credit hours, 40% of its majors. I mean, it felt like a ball rolling off a table.
David Reingold took over as dean of Purdue's College of Liberal Arts in 2015.
I could show you some projections which would have showed, you know, by 2024 there would be no students left in this college.
The reasons why are complex and debated. The shock of the 2008 financial crisis, the higher costs of college, a shift away from social sciences to technology, seen as better for job prospects, and a devaluing of the very idea of a canon of great books. For Reingold, it added up to a reality that struck at the very heart of what colleges are for.
Once you get to a point where some of the domains which gave rise to the modern research university are either withered or non-existent, I think we've sort of lost what it means to actually have a university.
So it's kind of democratic.
Yeah.
Okay, good.
The answer here, Cornerstone, which begins with a two-semester slate of classes that replaced written and oral communication requirements for freshmen. The strategy, to integrate the liberal arts into the overall curriculum, rather than standing or falling apart.
If you think you're just going to build a program and they will come, you're wrong. You have to take over requirements, and that's what we did. And we do it through great books, which we call transformative texts.
Homer, Huxley, and Shakespeare, but also Rumi, N. Scott Momaday, and August Wilson.
Here's Octavia Butler.
Zook and the more than 100 liberal arts professors teaching these courses choose from an ever-evolving list of more than 200 authors, spanning the ancient world to modern day, across continents, genders, and races. Students attend theater and music performances and take classes with actors, and also act out some of their own work, based on text they're reading.
I call this court to order.
Including a trial of Victor Frankenstein from Mary Shelley's novel, a fine way into debating AI and other monsters of today. In 2017, the pilot program comprised 100 students. Now there are more than 5,000 taking Cornerstone classes.
It is so different from what I thought it was going to be.
Students like freshman Nathaniel Dixon Jr., who's studying neurobiology, but finds here something different in terms of class size and approach.
I was really worried at first, being a STEM major, but being here now, it is so great. And we've been doing a lot of Plato readings, Kant, Burke, and it's one of the first times that I found a lot of joy in my reading. And
really? I mean, in what way? Joy in what sense?
My professor, she really pushes the idea that what we're reading can be applied to us. And the point of the class isn't to find the correct answer, but find how what's in the reading can be applied to you in the grand scheme of the thing.
Other schools are paying attention, and Cornerstone-based programs have spread to more than 70 colleges across the country with help from foundation and other funding. That includes community colleges, home to more than 40% of all undergraduates.
Historically, there's not been a lot of thought about what that experience in general education at community colleges should really be.
And so government and humanities professor Ted Haji Antich set out to change that at Austin Community College in Texas with a seminar called The Great Questions, a general education requirement level class. And he sees a benefit that goes beyond the individual students.
You have people from all different places in life. You've got younger people, you've got older people, people that want nothing to do with politics and people that won't shut up about it. And they're in the same classroom and you're asking them to talk about Homer. And it's the only time they're ever going to get that experience. And if they don't get that experience at community colleges, they're increasingly not going to get it at other places.
You're making an implicit argument that they need that or that that does benefit them.
I think it not only benefits them, I think it benefits us. Representative democracy, which is has at its core the requirement that we're able to talk to each other across differences that actually matter.
But all this raises a further question. While Cornerstone might be good for the STEM students, does it ultimately foster and preserve the liberal arts disciplines themselves? At Purdue, the hope is that students exposed to transformative text as a requirement will want more. And the university now offers a Cornerstone certificate, a kind of minor. And the success of Cornerstone has already allowed Purdue to hire more than 100 new liberal arts faculty, bucking trends elsewhere. Though these new hires are required to teach at least half their courses in the Cornerstone program.
And in fact, now we have more philosophers than we had 10 years ago. Now, there's conflict in that because obviously the philosophy department does not want to sort of see the teaching commitments of their faculty pulled away from their core discipline. But we're trying to find a middle ground where we can have a robust philosophy department who's engaged in serious philosophical scholarship, as well as working to serve the broader student population here.
And what does serving students mean to Melinda Zook?
I'm not trying to get students away from engineering or business degrees. I'm trying to give them just a much more complete education while they're here at Purdue. I often look at my students and I think your life is going to be filled with crucial choices. Will you make the right ones? And if you don't know anything, right, if you don't know anything about the world or yourself or others, how can you?
As the famous ancient Greek inscription at the Temple of Apollo at Delphi put it, Gnothi sauton, know thyself. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Jeffrey Brown at Purdue University in West Lafayette, Indiana.
In February of this year, Alexei Navalny died in a Russian prison camp 3 years after he returned to his homeland. Navalny was Vladimir Putin's most prominent critic, an anti-corruption crusader who evolved into a political threat to Putin's near quarter-century rule. He survived a nerve agent poisoning by Russian operatives in the summer of 2020, but insisted on returning to continue his fight to change his nation. Navalny's memoir is being published tomorrow, posthumously, shepherded by his wife, Yulia, who has taken on his mantle of political leadership. Navalny wrote while recovering from the poisoning, and later surreptitiously in prison. Yulia Navalnaya met Amna Nawaz yesterday in New York to discuss her husband's life and his work for this memoir, Patriot.
Yulia, thank you for being here. Welcome to the NewsHour.
Hello, thank you so much for having me.
So as we sit here and speak now, it's been 8 months since your husband died. How are you doing?
Everything has changed in my life. This work on book and all this meeting with politicians, conferences, they give me a power, but very much different than 8 months ago.
It gives you a power, you said. What do you mean by that?
To continue Alexei's fight, to continue to do things to keep his legacy, to continue to keep memory about him in people's minds. Everything of this is very important for me.
There was one moment that really stood out to millions of people. That was when you and Alexei returned to Russia in January of 2021, after he had been recovering in Germany, after nearly dying from being poisoned by Russian agents. And you and he walked through the terminal after you landed. And then he was immediately arrested in customs and imprisoned, never to be free again. Did you know at that moment that that may be the last time you were together?
I didn't think about that at that moment. I knew that we are going at our homeland. We wanted to go there. I knew that it was very important for my husband to come back to Russia, to show that he's not afraid, to show and to encourage all his supporters not to be afraid. I knew that it's very important for him, and I knew that it could be dangerous, but I knew that he would never do it in another way.
He began writing this as he recovered in that German hospital, but he continued to write during his time in prison this last time. Why was it so important, do you think, to him to continue to write in this way, to make sure that these words got out?
You're right. He started to write in Germany and he continued to write in prison. He wasn't allowed to have a notebook and a pen more than for 1 hour a day.
He wrote this in 1 hour increments.
Yes, and even last month, even less. But still, we are very lucky to get some of his prison diaries. Nobody knows how many of them are lost. Because after his death, we got nothing from prison. Like, no personal belongings were given to us back.
So you think there could be more of his words, more of his writing?
I don't think that. I know in what conditions he was. Everything was taken by police and FSB, so I'm sure that we will never get anything from his personal belongings.
He was known to the entire world as Vladimir Putin's fiercest, most prominent critic and a political opponent, as sort of an unflinching voice against the forces of corruption. But I was really struck in reading this by just how funny he was, by his sense of humor. Is that something that stood out to you? Was that always there?
It's one of the parts of him which I liked a lot. He was really very funny, and I'm happy that book is written so, and even in English, you can feel how funny he was. It's the main thing why people loved him so much, why people supported him so much, why he became a leader of opposition, because he was very ordinary man.
You made each other laugh.
A lot.
There's a real love story in these pages too. And there's this moment he shares about the very first time he saw you, when you two lock eyes. He writes in the book that he says to himself at that moment, "This is the one. This is the girl I will marry." Do you remember that moment differently when you read it, or do you remember it the same way he did?
I remember it differently.
Do you? What's your memory of that?
I liked him a lot. He was very funny from the first day. He was very clever. But of course, I didn't have such thoughts like he will be my husband one day now.
When did you realize?
When he proposed me.
That's not before then?
That's what I remember.
He didn't arrive at his political views on an impulse, and he goes into great detail and really great historical detail in the book about why he came to believe what he did, why he came to distrust the system and to challenge the system. And this surprised me. He offers the Chernobyl nuclear plant disaster as an example from his youth. Why do you think that was such a formative experience for him?
Part of his family lived in Chernobyl, and it was very obvious for him that parents discussed one thing at home, and then when he switched on and watched TV, there are other news.
This idea of officials who lie to their people, he comes back to this again and again in the book. Was that really the source of his inspiration, of his dedication to his work?
I don't think it's about lies, the biggest part of these, but still it's about corruption, about that these people, they are not serving their country, they are not serving their people, they are serving their own interests.
I guess the question, if it's so deeply entrenched, can it ever be changed?
Of course, it can be changed one day. It's a difficult process when you're living under tyranny, and there is dictatorship in Russia.
There is the obvious question in all of this, Yulia, which is, you know, especially as you're raising your kids and you're considering your lives ahead, a lot of people will wonder, why did you go back and why did you stay? Did you ever think we just shouldn't go back?
I knew that if we would stay in exile, he wouldn't be happy.
But he may have been safe.
That's true.
It was worth it to you, even after he nearly lost his life, after being poisoned by Russian agents, knowing the target on his back, you still felt it was worth it to go back to Russia.
Now it's a difficult question, but at that moment I knew that he wouldn't change his mind and he would come back.
Knowing what you know about Vladimir Putin, do you believe he would have your husband poisoned in prison?
Of course, I'm sure that he did it.
What does justice look like for you, if that's the case?
There are two things which I would love to see. Vladimir Putin in prison, in Russian prison, like my husband was. And the second is that Russia will become normal, democratic country, about which my husband so dreamed.
Do you see that happening? Knowing where the opposition movement is right now, knowing that your husband is no longer there to lead it, how do you see that happening now?
That's very important to believe. It's very important, like my husband said, not to give up, just to do anything you can do every day.
What role do you see for yourself in that?
It doesn't matter about role. I would like to come home, to come back home to Russia. I would love to live in Russia. I never dreamed to live somewhere else.
Yulia, the opposition in Russia suffered an enormous blow with the loss of your husband, and there's been reports of it being fractured and leaderless. When you look at the opposition right now in Russia, where do you see signs of hope?
Everywhere. I think that we all the time, every day, need to keep our hope. And all these people inside Russia who are against Putin's regime, against war, and I very hope that one day everything will change. But it's just not hope, it's belief. I understand that it could take a long time, but still, as I said, we just need to do anything every day.
Just visiting your husband's grave is an act of resistance. What do people do or say when they visit? What do you hear?
There are a lot of fresh flowers still after 8 months passed. Somebody say that Alexei has changed their mind. They believed in politics and in politicians in Russia again. I hope to come back to Russia one day. And the first thing which I'm going to do, to go to the cemetery.
Yulia Navalnaya. Thank you so much for sitting and speaking with us today. We appreciate it.
Thank you.
And there's a lot more online right now, including a look at how the Cherokee Nation is finding solutions for a lack of affordable housing. That's at pbs.org/newshour. And that is the News Hour for tonight. I'm Jeff Bennett. For all of us here at the PBS News Hour, thanks for spending part of your evening with us.
Major funding for the PBS News Hour has been provided by...
On an American Cruise Lines journey, travelers experience the maritime heritage and culture of the Maine coast and New England islands. Our fleet of small cruise ships explore American landscapes, seaside villages, and historic harbors, where you can experience local customs and cuisine. American Cruise Lines, proud sponsor of PBS NewsHour.
Supported by the John D. and Catherine T. MacArthur Foundation, committed to building a more just, verdant, and peaceful world. More information at macfound.org. And with the ongoing support of these institutions. This program was made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you.
You're watching PBS.